Okay, so now about this course, it's called the Introduction to Bioinformatics and Computational Biology. If you ask what is that difference, very specifically, there are some small differences. Bioinformatics focus a bit more on the creation of tools such as algorithms, databases, web servers that really solve some computational problem for a biologist. The goal is to build useful tools that work on the biological data. It's more focused on the CS or engineering side. Whereas computational biology focuses more on the study of biology using these computational techniques. The goal is to learn new biology, knowledge about the living systems. It's more about discovery. But for the current course, we are gonna just use them interchangeably. And I hope you will also see throughout this course, we are hoping that you can move between them. So several years ago, I wrote a blog about levels of bioinformatics or level of computational biology. So I defined them into these five levels. The first level is modeling for modeling's sake, and I hope you don't get there. So I remember once some people asked me, oh, there's so much public data available. What should I do? And so I asked them, well, depending on what questions do you want to solve? And they say, I want to solve modeling questions. And so if they don't really know what biological question they want to really solve, they might be doing some modeling that nobody really cares. It doesn't really answer a real question at least biologists or computational biologists, if they don't really care about it. They can actually create a field and have their own journals and, you know, conferences that they go to. I hope we don't need to go there. For this course, we actually start from the entry level, which is level one. We try to teach you to use published tools to analyze data and generate hypotheses for experimentalists. And so in this course, we are not going to really ask you to write, we are going to ask you to write some simple scripts in R or Python to manipulate data. You'll also be using a lot of the very well-established bioinformatics tools to really make sense out of the data. That's, I think, a good entry point to go in and to understand why experimentalists do this experiment, how the algorithms are developed, and how you can use it and make sense out of this data, and based on the results, can generate some hypotheses, or at least tell the experimentalists whether their experiment worked or not. Right, so that's the first level. But the second level of bioinformatics is more kind of focused on the bioinformatics aspect. You develop an algorithm or database or website for data analysis. Very often these are done on new technologies, say a new sequencing technology. So for example, the new thing in the last couple of years or maybe even longer is single cell RNA-seq and maybe single cell ATAC-seq and recently spatial transcriptomics, right? So how to do this new technique data analysis, how to do data integration of all the public data and reuse them and so on. And so the second level is just developing algorithms. The third level is more towards computational biology, which is using all the publicly available data. Think about some really clever and creative ways to use either algorithm that you develop or publicly available through integration and modeling, really make a discovery on the biology side. And these ones, sometimes you will need an experimental validation on the hypothesis you generate. But at that time, the difference I would say from level one to level three is level one, very often the bioinformatician, they don't own the problem. It's usually a biologist approaching the bioinformatician to say, hey, I have this problem, I have this data, I want to answer a question. Here is the data, can you help me, right? Bioinformatics at level two, I think it's already, as a computational biologist or a bioinformatician, you own the problem because you know that here are some public data, there is a need to develop better tools, I can develop this, I can publish this as a tool to help a lot of other groups, not just my own collaborator. But for level three, also is a kind of a computational person thinking there's all this public data. They come up with a question to ask, themselves, which is a biology question, right? How do I use public data to make sense and generate hypotheses, which then an experimentalist can help them with validation. And recently, because of consortiums such as ENCODE and TCGA, they generate a lot of data. Very often you have a big team of scientists, sometimes hundreds of scientists working together to decide they publish a paper or a group of papers, a series of papers together on the data generated from the consortium. So the last level is more team scientists. And so I hope that actually as a good computational biologist, eventually you can learn to do all four levels, not quite level zero, but you know, from one all the way to X. But in this course, we're gonna teach you more about level one, but also show you roughly how the level two bioinformatics algorithm are developed and what's the assumptions, you know, what approach they are using and so on. So the characteristics of bioinformatics and computational biology, one is that it is super interdisciplinary. I know this course is offered as a statistics course, but you can see from the audiences, we really target all three. You can see in the course, anytime you deal with numbers, abundance, you know, counts, normalization, differential abundance, those are mostly statistical approaches. And anytime you deal with just sequence, you know, you map the sequence into the genome, detect the mutations, and very often we use algorithms that are related to computer science. But both of these approaches, at the end, we're trying to answer biological questions. So this, you know, this field is really very interdisciplinary between statistics, computer science, and biology. And you can see there's a change in emphasis over time because of technology development. It's also a very applied field. For this course, over the years, we have seen students from freshmen to postdocs to come to the course. And this could be very, very useful training for many, many people, especially for biologists. In fact, the more you practice, the better you are. You cannot come to this course and expect to learn this without practice. And in fact, usually from my experience, when you finish the course, you can really start to do research. Before that, you are just trying to learn the very, very basic skills. And over the years, bioinformatics and computational biology has changed a lot. For example, as I mentioned, for many, many years, this course covered microarray analysis, and this is the first year we decided to take it out because most people don't really do microarrays anymore. And we have added now a new module or new lecture on single cell attack seek analysis, which kind of were a new technology from the last year. And so you want to ask, is this really a class for me? Am I prepared for this? For this course, we do need some reasonable amount of computing, for example, R and Python. You should know enough programming ahead of time. If you don't know anything, I have seen cases where a PhD biologist actually did extremely well in this course, but she worked her butt off to become very good. But if you don't have good programming skill, it's not impossible. It will be just really, really tough. For a biology background, you know, we hope that people have basic molecular biology and genetics, genomic type of knowledge. And in statistics, you need to know hypothesis testing. You need to know enough about distributions, you know, like, and also have good number sense and intuition. And so we are going to really cover the major questions, major techniques, and major solutions in computational biology, especially those that are related to mammalian animal genomes. We are not gonna cover as much in virus or bacteria because this actually is already very, very heavy as a course. We'll give you a lot of hands-on skills in computational biology and bioinformatics. You will learn how to analyze data and use a lot of the tools. And I would say for biologists, never to be afraid of the big data you are gonna get. So suck it up in the course, it's gonna be hard. And this is not really a statistical theory or, you know, like if you wanna do equation deductions, we are not gonna cover that. That then if you're looking for this, this is not the course for you. We want to use this homework one to check your preparedness. And homework one, we really tone down the difficulty. You should be able to finish them in a few hours, ideally about 5-6 hours. If on homework one, you already spend over 10 hours, the rest of the course is gonna be too hard for you. On average, the homework two and six will be 3 to 4 times the work as homework one. It's not an easy course. So in this course, we have a survey in every after each homework and after the previous years of surveys. Our estimation is that homework 2 to 6 on average would take about 20 hours, and it's 2 weeks every. It's a homework due every 2 weeks, so it's not an easy course. But I would say for biologists. So for the biologists in this course, I want to mention that it's not unusual for somebody in order to master a technique, spend about 6 months to do a new technique. You know, you spend hours and hours in the lab to generate the data. Then you spend another 6 months in front of a computer to decide whether your experiment even worked or not. If you can spend about 3 months time to really learn bioinformatics and never be afraid of big data again, it's really good time invested. And so even though the homework is hard, I think it will be a rewarding experience. You can look at the queue, you know, students' feedback from before. It will probably be one of the most useful courses that you can take or do yourself a favor for. So I want to quote here Sidney Brenner, who is the 2002 Nobel laureate. He said, this is an interview he gave in 2008. And I think this is even more true nowadays. In 2008, when high throughput sequencing just became available, he said, we presently have huge amounts of data that are largely unassimilated. I have discovered that while there are rewards for collecting data and distributing data, there is little, if any, support for organizing it. It is what I call low input, high throughput, and no output science. What does that mean? So low input means before you do an experiment, you say, this is something seek, right? I'm gonna spend a lot of money, process a lot of samples, and generate a lot of sequencing. So without thinking, just spend the money, and you generate a high throughput, you know, a lot of data, and no output is at the end. You don't know what you found or whether your experiment even worked or not, right? So this is even true nowadays, because 2008, look, remember the sequencing at that time? You know, we are really dealing with not just 10 times more data, it's like 100 times more data. And this is another paper that's published by a computational biologist, and this is published in PLOS Biology. And he says, all biology is computational biology. Nowadays, every biologist uses high throughput technique because it's just so much more powerful. It allows you to learn things much, much faster, to gain insights that you would have never been able to generate. But the bottleneck is, after you generate the data, can you make sense out of this? And so if you are a biologist, ask yourself, can I afford not to learn computational biology? And there are bioinformatics courses offered elsewhere. This one is really going to give you the hands-on skills that you will never be afraid of data anymore, even though initially it might be a struggle. Okay.